Okay, thank you. Well, first I'd like to thank the organizers for the invitation. And well, I need to say that probably you see a different seminar here because I will not talk about elaborate models and carbon nanotubes and things like that. I will consider the most basic model used since pyres and the buyers, chain of unharmonic oscillators. The good thing about using this basic model is that we can, hopefully, we can get some general results. And the bad thing is that sometimes we have some, you know, some problems which require a lot of work. So, okay. I will talk about thermal rectification as, okay. This seminar is based on several works carried out with the help of some colleagues, such as Giulio Casati, who is here, Jiao Wang, Shunda Shen, Humberto Lemos, Ricardo Avila, and Mendonça, these guys from my department there in Belo Horizonte. They are my ex-students. Okay, so turn to this basic question related to the microscopic mechanism of heat conduction. Well, we have some seminal problems and old problems, but still open. For example, the Fourier law. The Fourier law, as have a lot of people has talked about it here, and it has been proposed almost 200 years ago by Fourier. And it says that the heat flow, for example, in a bar in an insulated solid is proportional to the gradient of temperature. And you know, as you have said, for example, the parabolic heat equation is based on it. So we see the of heat equation is based on it. We can see this when we open our first book of partial differential equation. We see example of parabolic equation, the heat equation. The heat equation is based on the Fourier law, so it's important to try to understand the Fourier law. And well, there are a lot of works, but up to now we don't have the mathematical precise and necessary and sufficient conditions for the occurrence of Fourier law. Okay, and still talking about these seminal problems and. For example, for the one-dimensional systems, we have a lot of works, for example, numerical works related to the potentials, the invariant, the translational invariant potentials, and we have also some theoretical work saying, for example, the Prosen-Campbell theorem, but there is a problem with the proof of this theorem. But anyway, saying that. We will not find the Fourier law in such systems. That is, if you try to write the, if you try to write the heat flow as the gradient of temperature, we will get a thermal conductivity that goes to infinity as we increase the system size. And the question is that there are a lot of you know, it's still an open problem to decide the value of alpha, the value of the divergence, the exponent of divergence here. Well, in fact, we don't know if we have just one, we have two or more. But okay, anyway, besides this seminal and very important open problem related to this the microscopic mechanism of heat flow, there are a lot of, you may find in literature, a lot of papers and carried out by people who are here in this room, for example, and very interesting results and so on. And we see, for example, some investigation involve another questions, for example, involve the manipulation control of the heat flow and some of these questions with practical applications. Well, for example, inspired by the amazing progress of modern electronics due to the invention of transistor and electric diode and things like that, we have phononics. That is, several people have tried to build a similar device in order to control the heat flow. Okay, and so, but the problem with that is that up to now we don't have a good diode. I mean, the diode, the thermodiode, a good thermodiode. The thermodiode is the basic element, you know, in these devices too. Well, thermodiode, as everyone here knows, is a device. Jesus Christ, I need to make a course to use. Okay, what? Where is thermodiode? Thermodiode is here. It's a device in which the heat has a preferential direction. That is, the magnitude of the heat flow changes as we invert the device between two thermal baths. And it has, as far as I know, it has been proposed by Casati almost 15 years ago. Okay, and see, for example, here, if it put them asymmetric, of course, we find the thermal rectification just in asymmetric model. If you put this model here, for example, between two thermal baths, that we have the white bath is the hot bath here. Then in this, the first situation, we have the heat coming from the hot bath to the cold bath. When we invert the bath, we will see an inversion in the direction of the heat flow. So, of course, the heat flow will go from the hot bath to the cold bath. But if the magnitude of the flow besides the direction changes, then we say that we have a thermal rectification. That is it. Okay, so the user proposal of the rectification is given by a sequential coupling of different unharmonic parts, for example, something like by two or sometimes three different unharmonic systems coupled. And the problem with the systems is that the rectification power is small and fastly decays to zero as we increase the system. So it's a problem. And we have several other proposals related to quite specific modes, but I will not talk about this. I talk about just general systems. Okay, for example, another good proposal is a system grid given by a graded chain, for example. Graded, it means graded material is a homogeneous material whose structure changes gradually in space. For well, I guess I have a. See, this here we have a graded system. The mass of the particle is growing as we go from the left to the right. So the we can understand the graded material as, how can I say, the most exaggerated coupling of parts. We have. So we expect to have a better rectification related to the graded systems. And in fact, we have shown that thermal rectification is a ubiquitous phenomenon in unharmonic graded materials. And we have studied several kind of chains of oscillators and other models too, and we have found thermal rectification in these graded materials. Okay, so our proposal in order to find a general good rectifier, thermal rectifier, is to study graded materials, that is the most exaggerated version of parts of unharmonic systems, together with long-range interparticle interactions. And we have done that. I will talk about our feelings and our results then. That is a system with our system will be given by something like this, a chain of oscillators with interparticle harmonic interactions with unharmonic on-site potentials and with baths at the boundaries. And we need to, well, due to technical problems for the analytical results, we take systems with inner baths too. But we study the system in a self-consistent condition. It means in the steady state, we'll choose the temperatures of the baths in such a way that we will not see a net heat flow from the inner reservoirs to the systems. So the reservoir will just, say, act as some mechanism of von scattering one. They will not introduce energy in the system. What? Yeah, yeah. They act on the system. But they act on the system. But are you write the equations? Then you see. But okay, but they do not, in the steady state, I will make some adjustment in order to avoid to get heat from the inner reservoirs to the system in the steady state. Well, that's not my model, in fact. A lot, no, unfortunately not. I did not have this idea. But well. Okay, I will talk about this too. Well, our feeling about the idea of studying systems with long-range interaction is that with long-range interactions, we have new channels for the heat transport. And so, well, we have, as we increase the system, we have a competition between the usual decay of the heat flow versus the emergence of the new channels that favors, these channels favor the heat flow. So it can, how can I say, yeah, you know, we can. And that's true, in fact, we will show that, at least for this kind of models. And, well, there is another ingredient, too, that is in favor of system with long-range interactions. Well, besides the emergence of new channels, we also have, more asymmetry in the systems as you increase the system. You may, why is that? Well, it's easy to see. See, for example, here, with nearest neighbor interaction one, this the small particle here sees one, this large particle here. But with long-range interaction, the small particle sees the large particle and the other much large particle and the other much, much large particle and so on. That is, the large particle sees this small particle with nearest neighbor interaction, but with long-range interaction, this large particle sees this small particle and this much small particle and this much, much small particle. So in some sense, we are increasing the asymmetry and also the number of heat channels. So the asymmetry means well, you know, it's similar to the graded structure. It of course the asymmetry in the systems favors the rectification. So that's our idea. We believe that we can good term rectifiers with graded systems and with long range interactions. That's our idea to study this system in details. Okay, and well, we have performed analytical studies and also numerical studies. So I will first talk about the analytical studies. So we take a chain of oscillators. You know, the picture is as in well, like here, we take a chain of oscillators coupled to thermal baths that will give by stochastic variables. I will introduce this in detail later at the boundaries. And it, I said there are because okay, consider and we will take also this stochastic bath coupled to the inner sides too. And okay, so you take this N oscillators with this Hamiltonian, the usual Hamiltonian, that is we have the kinetic energy here and the harmonic oscillator potential, the interparticle interaction. We always consider harmonic interparticle interactions, but of course you can take, but here we talk just about the harmonic interparticle interaction. And we also take this unharmonic oscillator potentials too. For example, something like a 5-4 potential. Okay, so the dynamic of the system will be given by the usual Hamiltonian equations here. So here, well, besides the usual equation for the mechanical equations, we have these terms here. They describe the noise introduced in the system. We have noise for not just for the site one and N, I mean for the boundaries, but for the inner sides too. And that is some dissipation that we need to introduce in the system, of course, in order to get a steady state. Otherwise, we don't have a steady state. And okay, so the idea to study this system, this 2N equations, nonlinear stochastic equation. Well, you know very well that it may be difficult to study nonlinear differential equations. Okay, but anyway, so I will describe already. So as I have said, the B there means white noise, and so it's not a new model. This model, that's the harmonic version of this model, has been introduced almost 50 years ago. So it's quite old model, but it has been revisited, for example, by Joel Leibovitz, Bonetto, Lucarini and Leibovitz have solved exactly the harmonic version of this model in 2004. And here, I will treat the unharmonic version of the model. So you may say, well, why? See, when this Busterly, Hirsch, and Vischer have introduced this model, the idea was to study a simpler model to describe this, how can I say, the unharmonic systems. But there, they did not consider unharmonic interaction. They say that the inner potential, in some sense, they were mimicking, you know, the unharmonic interaction absent in the Hamiltonian. So that was the idea. Then you may say, but why you are taking this much more complicated version here? Well, the fact is that the harmonic version that I have just said, that the version has been solved by Bonetto, Lucarini, and Leibovitz in 2004, the question is that the thermal conductivity does not depend on the temperature. And I have proved with another guys that for this model, even for the asymmetric version of this model, we don't have thermal rectification. So that's interesting because, you know, the harmonic chain of oscillators, of course, we don't have the Fourier law does not hold in the harmonic version. Everyone here knows, and we have a rigorous results by Riedel, Leibovitz, and Libet. Anyway, everyone knows very well. And But the harmonic with inner reservoirs, the harmonic chain of oscillators with inner reservoirs, this model obeys the Fourier law. So in some sense, there is some unharmonicity in the system, but it obeys, but it's not so rich because, you know, the thermal conductivity does not depend on temperature. So we don't see some things in this model. So we need to introduce this unharmonic terms. Okay, and then in order to study the energy, what should I do? Well, we define the energy of each site as usual, okay? That is, the energy of each oscillator is given by the kinetic energy plus the on-site potential, and the interparticle potential is divided by the two involved sites. So, okay, and then we study the derivative of the energy in time, and then we get an expression like this. This first term here is given by this expression. It means the energy flow from the bath J to the site J. So the self-consistent condition that I have talked about means it's necessary to choose the temperature of the inner reservoirs in such a way that this term here is zero in the steady state. So you may say, is it possible? Yeah. There is a theorem. It's possible. this problem is a little bit complicated. This theorem has been proved by, again, Bonetto, Leibovitz, Lucarini, and Ola in a large paper for the unharmonic version. They have proved one that there is a steady state, a unique steady state with the self-consistent condition just yet. They did not calculate the thermal conductivity and things like that. So I will talk about this here, the thermal conductivity for this model. And so, so we derive the equation for the change in time for the energy. And then in the steady state, of course, this term here will be zero. And this other term that is related to the energy flow from the site J to the site J, well, as I have said, it has been already proved that it's possible to find this T such that we can make this zero in the steady state. And then we'll just have what? We have the energy current, the heat current. See, that is from the previous site to the site J here. It means minus, it means the heat that comes from the previous site to the site J. And the last term here means the heat that comes from the site J to the ongoing system. Okay, so if you pay attention, you may note that for the interparticle interaction given by a quadratic term, so it means the derivative. So we'll get, it disappears for the harmonic term. Then we'll get the current, the heat current will be given by this two-point function here related to the key and P. So all that we have to do in order to talk about the heat current in this model to study the two-point function in the steady system. But it's even difficult, at least for me. Okay, so what will you do? Well, I will describe an approach then here. So first of all, we'll take in a first step, please pay attention. We'll take the lambda equal to zero. Lambda means the unharmonic coefficients. So, where is it? Oh, here. We'll take this term zero and also this term here. So we'll just stay with the isolated oscillators, and then we'll get, here I have put this, the interparticle interaction too, but anyway, well, without the unharmonic terms, we can rewrite the equation, the dynamic equation, in the this, well, we have two notations for the phi. That's phi here. For this vector in this phase space, you know, this we can write something. We get an equation like this, and we can solve this equation. The linear, it's a linear problem. We can solve this. Of course, we can some complicated expressions, and so it will give us Ornstein-Lembeck process, and we can solve it exactly, and we can calculate. It will give us a Gaussian process, so we can calculate the covariance and all that, and we are done. I mean, for the harmonic term. In fact, as I have said, Bonetto, Leibovitz, and Lucarini have solved this problem, the harmonic version of this model. So our idea here is, in a first step, to take the harmonic term. In fact, we always take to solve the harmonic part, we always turn off the interparticle interaction. And then we study the complete process by using the Gierzanov theorem or Cameron-Martin formula. I don't know if you are used to that, but it's a tool for stochastic differential equations. The Gierzanov theorem, for example, for a given differential equation, stochastic differential equation, the or the Gierzanov theorem tells us the solution of a different equation. Of course, there are a lot of conditions, and I will not talk about this here. But when we add some terms here, we can write the correlations of this new problem here in terms of the correlations of this initial by this very famous formula named Cameron-Martin formula or Gierzanov theorem. And okay, so I have written this here. So I can write, see, this J means the unharmonic part, let me say. So, and this means the harmonic systems. I can solve the harmonic. And the unharmonic, the correlation, because I need the correlation, the two-point function correlation. I can write the two-point function correlation for the unharmonic systems in terms of the correlations of the harmonic systems. Of course, I have this term, this Z term here, and well, it's a complicated term. But see, it's something like exponential of minus V, let me say, some complicated interaction. So the Gierzanov theorem gives us an expression similar to a partition function. For example, we have E minus V times Gaussian measure. So you say, oh, that's very good. Why? Because we have replaced 2n nonlinear stochastic equations by an integral representation. Well, there are lots of tools in order to study this. You know, field theory and it's similar to a Feynman-Katz expression or a partition function in statistical mechanics. Okay, and of course we have very intricate interactions. But anyway, so we may say, okay, that's wonderful. So we have this integration. So we can expand this and to make calculations. Well, but that's not a good idea. Why not? Because see, this measure here has been obtained for the harmonic term. And you know, we are trying to study the unharmonic system by using a measure for the harmonic for the simpler version. But you know, these versions are quite different. It's exact that's okay, but it means that if you try to expand this, we will have problem with the expansion. as we have in field theory, for example, we cannot just, you know, sometimes we have a lot of problems, you know, we do not have convergent expansion and things like this. So it's necessary to you know, a lot of work in order to get some information. So our idea is to introduce discrete time and to rewrite, in order to rewrite this expression here. That is, what does it mean? It means I write the covariance, the Gaussian measure as something like this, and then we'll get this expression here for the two-point function. We'll get exponential minus a lot of things time defy here. Of course, I'm taking now finite times, and of course, I need to study later the when the time goes to infinity, because I want to get the steady state. But we start with a finite system, and in order to get something useful, I will not get the measure, the Lebesgue measure here, of course. I will get, for example, this the large unharmonic parts and put in the together with this d phi, then we'll stay with integral representation like this. That is, we have the representation for the two-point function and then for the heat flow in terms of this phi here that are related to the harmonic interaction, okay? But now we have a new potential and an unharmonic single spin distribution. I mean, single spin distribution, I mean something like this. I can see here, just here. Minus some function of phi. Let me put I here. Over normalization. Yeah, that's it. So, you know, I start from an unharmonic measure. And we succeed with this representation. Well, we have performed a lot of work. So we have carried out some huge computation. But you know, there are a lot of techniques in order to exploit this integral representation here. We use we show that by using polymer expansion, we show that it's possible to get a treatable and convergent perturbative analysis from this integral representation here. I don't know if you're used with this polymer expansion. Polymer expansion means cluster expansion in field theory, for example. What is that? It came with the Meyer expansion. Have you heard about this? That is, for example, I have something like this. Then I write. So I don't know how to calculate it. So what do you do? Let me put that. What do you do? We do something like, it's quite rough. Of course, there are a lot of results and several books of mathematical physics dedicated to the polymer expansion. I do something like this. So we have a product that see that's exactly the same. So we can get something like this here. And times one here. So I don't know if you see. We have a lot of things like that. So we can get one, and all. So we have something that join all the points. We can write this as a combination of things. That is, I have something like this. I can write this as the sum of several things, you know, restricted to small parts of the space. so we can control all the things. There are a lot of things related to that and theorems and all that battle, Bridges battle, Feder-Busch formulas and all that. But and so that's it. That's very interesting that we can control. That's it. But that's a very good thing. Why that's a very good thing? Because now I can perform. You know, see, for example, see the polynomial here. This term here, it's similar to, for example, if v is small, if you have a small parameter here, the first term here is, see, the exponential of v, the Taylor series, of course. Okay, so when we get this is proportional to this v here. So the polynomial will give when you perform, for example, a naive expansion there, it coincides with the first term of the polynomial expansion. So if the polynomial expansion is convergent, we can do what any student do, you know, take a complicated expression and expand and all that. It will work. It's wonderful. Yeah. No, that's difficult to have something like that. Well, at least to me, it's... Okay, so we do that then, and then we calculate the two-point functions for this unharmonic chain of oscillators, and then we get something for the flow from J to L, we'll get something like this. And this K here will depend on T and will be a very complicated expression. And that is, well, we'll get a set of equations related to the flow. For example, the first equation here, we have that's the flow that comes from the first bath to the first side. And this other, the right side of the expression here gives the flow that comes from the side one to the side two, the flow that comes from the side one to the side three, the flow that comes to the side one to the side n. And this other expression here means that is the flow that comes from the side one to the side j, the flow that comes from the side two to the side j, and so on. And here, the side that comes outside the side j to the side j plus one, and so on. So we get the expressions for the heat, and then we can write this expression like this here. But we still have a problem to solve this because this k is a complicated function that depends on T2, T1, and on the parameters related to the site one and site two, and in a complicated way. Yeah, you know, everyone knows here that the local term conductivity for the unharmonic system depends on temperature. Okay, in our case, I have not said that is our inter-particle interaction. We'll consider something like this. As I have said, we'll take one harmonic inter-particle interaction. So for the long-range inter-particle interaction, you'll get something like that. That is the difference of the position of the two sides divided by something that decays with the distance between the sides. And to get a convergent polymer expansion, we need to consider one integral potential. I mean, in d equal one, this potential shall decay like one plus something. I integral in this sense, then we can control the polymer expansion, and. Okay, then we studied this unharmonic with this approach that I have talked about here. We studied this unharmonic chain of oscillator with this inner reservoirs, and we take a particle with a graded mass distribution and inter-particle interaction with polynomial decay. And as I have told, I don't know how to solve the equations. After all that, we still have very complicated equations. Then we have considered only the case of a small gradient of temperature in the system. So the temperature of the system is something T plus some epsilon. So in the first order in epsilon, we solve the problem and calculate the heat flow and the rectifications and all that. And what do you find? See, we find here, see this graph B and D here. That is here we have graphs for the ratio of the system with long range interaction and the system with nearest neighbor interaction one. So we can see that the rectification, that's the ratio between the rectification of in the two systems. We see that with long range interaction, that is for a linear mass distribution here. We can multiply by C almost 5,000 the rectification factor. So in fact we can use the long range interaction in order to increase the rectification factor. And okay, so besides this, is it clear? See, we have here different distributions, different graded systems. For example, this first system here is a system with a linear mass distribution. This second here follows for a system with exponential distribution, but it's a decaying. It's a decaying. So for large j, it does not change much more. See, it's not growing exponentially. It's the mass distribution, something like that in the system. Okay, so we do not change very much the mass here for a long time. Because we are talking about infinitesimal temperatures. So yeah, that's a problem. Because in fact, anything here is small. Yeah, because we are considering an infinitesimal factor. Because we don't know how to carry out the calculation. So I will explain this. So we turn here to this problem, and then we write this k here in terms of this t, but t now depends on epsilon. And though I expand all that and just take the dominant term, I mean the order epsilon. So everything is very small. I don't know how to. Yeah, but anyway. No. That anything depends on epsilon here. Of course, for the harmonic, I can calculate in any regime. But of course, I can do something better. But just for as a first step, we have studied the system submitted to a very small difference of temperature. And then we get this. Yeah, that's the ratio of the rectification. We divide epsilon by epsilon. Yeah, both depends on that. Yeah, but anyways, I know that you are right. That is, we just have a heat flow that is proportional to epsilon, so we don't have, you may ask about, is it good or not? Because see, the ratio is very large, but anyway, both are small. You are right. But okay, then that's the work carried out with Kazat. Then we turn into computer simulations, and to perform computer simulation, we decide to consider unharmonic chain of oscillators, but now with reservoirs only at the end. Because you may ask, you say that, no, I don't like very much this reservoir. But of course, I can talk more about this problem with inner reservoirs. For example, we can take the coupling with the inner reservoirs small, and we can carry out simulations with that. That is, I believe that if I turn off the inner reservoirs, we'll have the same phenomenon, you know, for large inharmonicity. Why? Because the unharmonic potential will give the rectification, will give anything. We don't need this inner reservoir. But I don't know how to prove it mathematically, to prove to the theorem. I don't know. I cannot. I can make it small, but I cannot make it zero. Well, okay. So with to carry out computer simulations, we decide to study unharmonic chain of oscillators now with reservoirs only at the end. So that's okay. And again, we have taken particles or oscillators with graded mass distributions and interparticle interactions, also harmonic interparticle interactions and unharmonic on-site potential, of course, and interparticle interaction with polynomial decay, and now any gradient of temperature, of course, you don't need to take the system submitted to infinitesimal temperature that you have noted, yeah. And so, well, that's what you have noted. For example, for this case here, as we increase the temperature gradient, we see that, of course, the heatification factor increases for the system with nearest neighbor interaction, but it increases much more for the system with long-range interaction. See here. And also, here, that's the rectification factor. Yeah, the rectification as we increase as a function of the system size. As we know, for the system with nearest neighbor interaction, it decays even for the system with graded structure. Well, without the graded structure, it decays fastly, but here it decays, and with long-range interactions, you know, see, it is increased. Of course, you can ask me, where about n equal to 2,000? I don't know, but anyway, it shows to us that we can use this long-range interaction in order to increase. That's very interesting, in my opinion. Because see, we are taking very basic models given by chains of unharmonic oscillators. You know, that's the basic model that we see since the pyres in the bias. And there we see, when we have graded structures with long-range interaction, we may find a considerable rectification factor. So yeah, well, that's it then. Well, first I say something here that it's a danger to talk here. When I talk to mathematicians, I say that we see real materials and with the long-range interactions. But well, in fact, that potential, I have asked people from magnetism, and they told me that they have this nanodisk of permalloys with such potential, and then we have used this. So hopefully we will find several systems with this. okay, and so I repeat again that it seems interesting then to try to study systems with long-range interaction. Of course, it's not easy, but we can note different, you know, phenomena, and for example, the rectification. The thermal rectification increase when we introduce long-range interaction in a system, at least for this class of system. Well, okay, that's it. Thank you very much.